Welcome all to the inauguration of the working group of IYCF chapter of Kerala, hosted by IAP Trivandrum. Today, this chapter is dealing with a very important event on the complimentary day of IAP, complimentary feeding the bottleneck in IYCF practices act now. We know that infant feeding itself is complex, hence we had to make a working group on how to go about in improving the nutrition and also to evaluate why it is not done properly and how it can be rectified. Now we can move on to the inaugural ceremony of the working group of Kerala. I invite Dr. Santosh Kumar, President IAP Trivandrum, for the welcome address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, NGU. Good afternoon, all. Welcome to our first working group meeting of IYCF Kerala. Healthy survival of children is essential to ensure long-term impairment-free survival of the child, and hence the importance of IYCF, as we all know, like initiation of breastfeeding, continuing it for 6 months, and then complementary feeding, appropriate adequate complementary feeding at 6 months, and so on. So complementary feeding basically is a public health intervention next only to breastfeeding for the intact survival of the child. And that's why this particular day, the importance of this particular day. Let me first of all welcome the president of IYCF chapter, National Chapter 2021, Dr. Kedan Bharadwaj sir. Welcome, sir. Let me welcome Dr. Ramesh, President-elect 2021, Dr. T.P. Jayaraman, President Kerala IAP, Dr. Elizabeth, past National President of Nutrition Chapter, and presently previous HOD of Trivandrum Medical College, and now HOD of Mookambika Medical College, Ashok Kumar sir, my teacher, and now senior consultant in KIMS, Somasekhar sir, secretary IYCF 2021, in my successor Dr. Ajit Krishnan, HOD SAT Hospital, Dr. Sri Prasad, President, Nutrition Chapter 2021. Dr. S.S. Kamath, our past National President. Dr. Satish Tiwari, President, Human Milk Banking Bank Association. Dr. Narayanan, immediate past President, Kerala. Dr. Johnny Sebastian, our Secretary, Kerala. Dr. Riyas, National Executive Board Member. Dr. Praveen, our Secretary, Dr. Sibi, Dr. Indu, Dr. Priya, and all the senior faculty members, teachers, and friends. Welcome all to this inaugural session of working group. Over to Anju for the proceedings.
Thank you, sir. Now we have a virtual lamp lighting ceremony. We all know that the lamp symbolizes knowledge, and let us all pray and hope that the knowledge we impart today will improve our society as a whole. May I request Dr. Amit to kindly. Have a small theme song on complementary feeding sung by Dr. Meera, a consultant pediatrician.
പച്ചക്കറിക്കായ തട്ട് ഓരോ മുത്തശ്ശി പൊട്ടറ്റു ചൊല്ലി കുഞ്ഞോളി കുമ്പാളി മാമുണ്ട് ചാഞ്ചാടു. പച്ചക്കറിക്കായ തട്ട് ഓരോ മുത്തശ്ശി പൊട്ടറ്റു ചൊല്ലി കുഞ്ഞോളി കുമ്പാളി മാമുണ്ട് ചാഞ്ചാടു. വെള്ളരി പിഞ്ചുപോലും ചുമ്മാ കള്ള കണ്ണീരൊഴുക്കി തക്കാളി പപ്പാളി അച്ചങ്ങ മുച്ചങ്ങ പിച്ചങ്ങയോടൊപ്പം പിച്ച് നടന്ന് ചൊല്ലി കുഞ്ഞോളി കുമ്പാളി മാമുണ്ട് ചാഞ്ചാട്. കുഞ്ഞോളി കുമ്പാളി മാമുണ്ട് ചാഞ്ചാട്. കുഞ്ഞോളി കുമ്പാളി മാമുണ്ട് ചാഞ്ചാട്.
Thank you. Now we have none other than Dr. K.E. Elizabeth to introduce us on the theme of today's working committee. She is, as we all know, the professor in HOD of Pediatrics, Sri Mookambika Institute of Medical Sciences, Kulashekaram, former HOD of SAT Hospital, Trivandrum. She was the past National President Nutrition Chapter and also the State President of IAP Kerala. We all know that she has authored a lot of books on nutrition and has won awards for her papers, books, and as the best doctor also. Over to you, ma'am. Madam, kindly unmute.
Thank you very much. Chief guest of the day, CIAP President-elect Dr. Ramesh Kumar, IYCF National President Dr. Kaidanji, Secretary Dr. Somashekar, President Human Milk Banking Dr. Sadish Tiwari, State President Dr. Jayaraman TB, Secretary Dr. Joni Sebastian, Branch President Dr. Sandosh Kumar, Secretary Dr. Praveen, esteemed guests, faculty for today, senior IAPians and friends. I feel very happy and honored to be part of this long cherished dream come true event that is celebrating complementary feeding on the sixth day of sixth month, that is June 6th, for the first time in the history of IAP and perhaps the whole world maybe. This is meant for a behavioral change among the professionals and the society and not meant as a day for observance alone. And I thank Dr. Indu for being the one-man army organizing this whole event. As you all know, complementary feeding is the bottleneck, the weakest link in infant nutrition. In fact, we didn't plan a visit for anticipatory nutrition guidance at 6 months after the third dose of pentavalent immunization around 4 months, and then coming at 10th month for MR vaccination. Perhaps this was in accordance with the earlier practice of starting complementary feeding at 4 months of age. Maybe that is why our seniors did not think of a complementary feeding day. Now that we are fixing it at 6 months, it is mandatory that we have a visit for anticipatory nutrition guidance. But let us look at our tradition, which is deep rooted in our culture. Let us learn from the Annaprashna or the rice giving ceremony around 6 months. We fail to capitalize on this. And in some households, actually this ceremony became a stumbling stone as they keep on postponing it for visiting some convenient auspicious place or one parent to come from Middle East, etc. That was the problem. But now let us make it a point that we call all of them at 6 months and give them the necessary guidance. Now it is our time to champion this cause to prevent the triple burden of malnutrition. We know all the underweight, the overweight, the micronutrient malnutrition, and even the stunting is starting at 6 months to 1 year of age. Let us understand that eating time should not be a battle time. In many families, it is so. Today, Dr. Ubendra Kinjavadekar has released an audio clip telling that let us call them at 6 months and talk for 6 minutes on complementary feeding. So I'm appealing to my professionals and the community, let us speak about the complementary feeding and not weaning. Weaning means abrupt stopping of breast milk to many mothers and professionals. Let us speak about the 6 into 6 strategy. What is this 6 into 6 strategy? The first thing is that we always say Fatwa is the name for complementary feeding. It is an Arab word for something new. This is something new. A baby has the knowledge to suck and swallow liquid food, but a baby has to be taught to take the solid food. This should be a smooth transition. That is, Fatwa speaks for F. That these are the six letters. F stands for frequency. They don't know the frequency. A is for the amount, how much amount to be given to the baby. T is what is the texture, and V is what is the variety to be given. And A, it has to be an active process, not a passive process. That means it should be a responsive feeding. Then H stands for hygiene. So Fatwa is the first six letters we have to teach them. 3 minutes for this, and the next 3 minutes I must say, that is the six R. R into six. That is, speak about the right age, right place, right time. It should be a media-free time and a media-free zone. And two, recognition of feeding cues. We have to understand what is the hunger cue, what is the fullness cue also. Some mothers don't know what is full. They go on doing it. And acceptance and resentment. And that is recognition of the feeding cues is the second. Third is reciprocate to each cue in a positive manner. That is, play an active role by eye contact, gestures, voices, encourage them during feeding. It should be very enjoyable for the child. And then the fourth one is respect the infant and regulate the feed. No force feeding. And some people ignore them. Just don't look at them. Give the food and then go away. Maybe they waste it or they overdo it. Whatever they want to do, that is ignoring them. And in this, overworked mothers, many times they may be doing it, but they don't know it, that they have to respect the child also. Then reinforce all the positive behavior. I will say not as rewards. There is nothing, no R is for rewards. Don't give them all rewards like chocolates. I will give you chocolate if you take this food. It can be just a clap, a hug and kiss. That is it. You have done well. That is from when they finish a meal or accepting a new food. Then the last one is being a role model. If I say I don't take this curry, if I say I don't take green leafy vegetables, etc., the child is looking at you. Children do not listen to you, but they copy. They always copy you. So we have to be role models, and they should have a place to sit. We should inculcate table manners, giving, sharing, everything at this time. And I'm very happy that all of you have joined for this wonderful cause. And now we have a day to celebrate. Let us speak about complementary feeding. And this is really a dream come true. And understand it is the bottleneck. Act for it. I wish all success for this endeavor. Jai IIP, Jai Hind.
Thank you, ma'am. Now for the presidential address, I'll call upon Dr. Ketan Bharadwa, president of IYCF chapter of IAP and Human Milk Banking Association. He's also the national trainer for Poor Scholastic Performance Program, Ask IAP All About Fevers, Intact, Parenting for Peace, core committee member. He has also won the Limca Book of Records Award for Breast Milk Donation Camps and the WABA Gold for Breast Milk Promotion. Over to you, sir.
Very good afternoon, very good evening to everybody. And I'm very happy to be here with you all, the stalwarts from Kerala. And I remember my old days of coming there and learning from a few of you over here, especially Dr. Kunju. Thank you, madam, for calling me here. And I'm indebted to Madam Elizabeth for giving us such a nice theme of celebrating this complementary feeding day. Friends, government and everybody in our country had put in lots of efforts since so many years in improving the malnutrition status of the children of our country, with the knowledge that proper nutritional practices in infancy and childhood can lead to a very potent adult population when these children, they grow up and they grow up with their full potential not only in their growth but also in cognitive domain also, and they become very productive citizens in future. That is a well known fact, to the extent that World Bank has accepted the fact that proper nutrition can bring a very dramatic change in reduction in the poverty of the country. Despite of all this and despite of all the efforts, we had been trailing behind all these years. But with celebrations of World Breastfeeding Week, a lot of awareness has come amongst our colleagues and population and everywhere, so that now the breastfeeding rates are gradually improving, not dramatically, but gradually they are improving. And what we are looking forward is now that to improve complementary feeding, this was there was a bottleneck that what should be done. Again, Madam's idea of celebrating the things as complementary feeding day, that would be a great step forward in improving the whole scenario of nutrition in our country. And let us start things in different ways in celebration of complementary feeding. Let us use all our social media platforms. Let us make all small WhatsApp messages which are circulated, made viral, like say, what is complementary feeding in few lines? What should be given in few lines? What are the myths and what are the facts in few lines? What are the harms of bottle feeding? What are the harms of using commercial foods, etc.? So in this way, we can definitely celebrate the whole IYCF over the whole year, and I'm hopeful that we'll be able to bring so many changes. Not taking much time, I take a note of all the stalwarts over here, and I give my pranam to our chief guest, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, who is national President-elect 2021. I give my pranam to Dr. Jayaraman, the president of IIP Kerala chapter, Dr. Santosh Kumar, the president of IIP Thiruvananthapuram, and all the dignitaries who are here, like Dr. Satish Tiwari, Dr. Narayan, Dr. Johnny Sebastian, Dr. Riaz, the IIP EP member. And all the whole, I congratulate Dr. Meera for a very good theme song, which was very melodious, though I could not understand the words, but I think that I thank her. And also I thank all the moderators and panelists of today's session, and the whole team who is behind this. And with this, I congratulate the new work group of IIP Kerala for making a new sub-chapter of IYCF IIP chapter. And I'm sure that under the able leadership of Madam, the whole chapter will flourish, and the whole chapter will give new directions to the whole scenario of IYCF in our IIP and the country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now, may I call upon Dr. Ramesh Kumar, President IIP Elect 2021, to address and also release the video on complementary feeding. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, dear Anshu. Well, President of the IYCF chapter, most respected Dr. Kedan Paradwa, President of IIP Kerala, Dr. Jayaraman, President of First Branch, Trivandrum City Branch, our teacher, Dr. Santosh Kumar, our the past President of the Nutrition Chapter, and our dear Elsot Ma'am, my past President and my dear mentor, Dr. Santosh S.S. Kamath, and Dr. Somashekhar, the National Secretary of the Chapter, all the stalwarts of the nutrition field, as well as the stalwarts of IIP Kerala, Dr. Satish Tiwari, the president of the human milk banking, as well as the chapter, the stalwart from the nutrition chapter, the IYCF chapter, and the front runner for the IMS Act. Always I hear him always there, and my dear friends on the platform. Quite exciting evening where we had a very auspicious occasion where the lamp lighting, the knowledge being lighted there, as well as very melodious song from Dr. Meera, of course. So quite heartwarming to see the complimentary feeding day is being celebrated by the Indian Academy of Pediatrics this year. It goes stretches out a lot of efforts and commitment from the our passionate stalwarts in the nutrition field, as well as the infant and young child's feeding chapter field. May I congratulate Dr. Keradhan Paradu and Dr. Swamishekhar for the enthusiasm being built up on this chapter, and I appreciate their commitment to the IMS Act, because of course in the central IAP executive, as well as in all our email communications, a lot of pressure is there from Swamishekhar doctor always regarding anything which comes across from the industry or other aspects regarding the formula feeds. So that much is the visibility they are creating. And the nutrition chapter, of course, Dr. Elizabeth and Dr. Bendra and all other our friends, Dr. Satish Tiwari, Satish Agarwal, and Dr. Mallikarjuna from Bangalore, a lot of them, they are all taking efforts to put it across. And well, friends, this is the sixth day of the 6 months, complimentary feeding. We are here today. As noted by ma'am in that industry, ma'am, it was a well articulated one, and hats off to you for making that theme, Elizabeth ma'am. Very well. It is quite interesting to listen to you. You made it very crisp. That's you, as you said, it should be a behavioral change coming up at the age of 6 months. And I remember many a time, even with this, the information tsunami going across the IT parents. Well, of course, I am in Apollo right now. A lot of IT parents are there with me. And they asked me many a time, whether giving ragi, will it produce respiratory infections? Can we produce, make, get Serlac, and doctor, that's the best way. I tell them, you are sitting at home, work from home right now. Okay, we have got enough time. Still, we are prepared for Serlac. We were prepared for the what you get from the market. So it's a very difficult, all said and done, still we are not able to get it across to them. Many a time we fail, I believe. So their day, and now that we have the typhoid vaccine or maybe the flu vaccines or other things, giving us an opportunity to come across them at 6 months. Otherwise, maybe we are elder, earlier we had hepatitis B vaccine at 6 months. Well, we don't have an opportunity maybe after 4 or 3 months to meet them on a regular well baby visit. So this is something which gives an opportunity, and well, we have to take it forward on these occasions. Whatever occasions we have to capitulate on that and get it across to them. And celebrating days like this, complimentary, that gives us more visibility, and this stresses the importance of complimentary feeding on all aspects. And I'm so happy that the state has our in the state chapter IAP team has ventured into having the working group on IVCF. Well, it's in the for technical reasons it is being kept as a working group right now, but I'm certainly sure that this is going to be the chapter of the IVCF in Kerala, and it will be coming up in a big way with this massive presence. And they will have a lot of academic activities, as well as, these sort of type of awareness, parental awareness and awareness to the mothers, and these type of days being celebrated. And certainly Trivandrum branch has taken a great initiative here. I congratulate my Christian Indumadi ma'am for organizing this meeting here today, and the president of the IBCF chapter, Kerala, Dr. Sri Prasad, and Elsot madam, and Lalitha Kailas ma'am, with a lot of support from our Dr. Riyas, Dr. Ashok Kumar, Dr. Mohammed Kunyu, and all our Dr. Ajit Kumar from SAT team. And all of them are supporting well. And we hope that we will be taking off in a big way with this IVCF chapter in Kerala. Anju and Praveen are always there supporting the team with Dr. Sibi Abhiram and all the youngsters from Trivandrum. So, I am so happy that we got our Dr. Sugathan and many of our seniors who have joined for here today. Riyas is there. So, Parvati ma'am, so that's a great event here. And I'm so happy that we are having a video also to commemorate this occasion. And Dr. Praveen is there. It goes without saying, an absolutely amazing video will be at hand for the day. So I congratulate IAP Kerala chapter, the nutrition team, the IVCF team here, for the great journey ahead, which is well being inaugurated here today. and for celebrating, taking up this theme, celebrating the complimentary feeding day in a big way, and making it across to our the fraternity and to the parents in a big way on the aspects of complimentary feeding as an important milestone in the growth of the child. So may I take the privilege to formally put the video on place, and once again congratulations to all the stalwarts, and sincere gratitude for the opportunity to be there with my dear friends in the IVCA chapter, IAP Kerala, and the IAP Trivandrum. Thank you, and once again wishing a great day.
Hi everyone, it is very interesting to note that from this year onwards, that is 2021 onwards, the 6th day of 6th month, that is June 6th, is going to be celebrated as the complimentary feeding day. As you all know, this complimentary feeding is the weakest link in infant nutrition, because of the lack of awareness what to give, how to give at 6 months of age. Even though we did not celebrate this so far, it is deep rooted in our culture, that is the annaprashna or rice giving ceremony at 6 months. Let us capitalize on this and let us start complimentary feeding for every baby starting at 6 months of age. And this
the video will be played after the meeting again.
Thank you, sir. We have with us the State President of IAP Kerala, Dr. T.P. Jayaraman. Sir, I request you to address the gathering. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, everybody. Respected President of IYCH Chapter, Dr. Kedan Bardava, Dr. Elizabeth Madam, Dr. Somashekhar Nimbalkar, Dr. Sachi Kamath, the past National President, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, President-elect CIAP, Dr. Ashok Kumar Sir, Dr. Ajit Krishnan, Dr. Sri Prasad, President of the Nutrition Chapter, Elizabeth Madam, Dr. Parvati Madam, Lalita Kailas Madam, all the other dignitaries on the platform. I am so happy to participate in the inauguration of the working group of IYCS chapter in association with the complimentary feeding day being celebrated on June 6th, as Dr. Madam was telling, on the 6th month, the 6th day, and you are talking about introduction of the complimentary feeds. This is an important public health concern, and as you all know, complimentary feeding from at the appropriate age goes a long way in the overall health of the community. And I congratulate Dr. Elizabeth and Dr. Indu for this wonderful effort, because Madam was telling during the last year's conference on IYCF, which was held in Trivandrum, they had planned to inaugurate this group on the next year's complimentary feeding day. And I congratulate them on working to the target, and you have made it a reality, a very important subspecialty group of IAP Kerala. Thank you so much for this and for the excellent video you have released along with that. And I feel actually Kerala IAP had been doing many activities in connection with the IMS Act last week in association with the Breastfeeding Promotion Day on the May 21st. We had 4 wonderful programs in increasing the awareness regarding the IMS Act, breastfeeding, as well as it includes the infant food substitutes also comes under the Act. So we had so many programs on that, and in continuation now we are having the program on complimentary feeding. So it's a great effort, and actually one of our branches, IAP Pathanamthitta, under the leadership of Dr. Jijo, had released a few videos on introduction of complimentary feeds, and Dr. Elizabeth Madam had released it, I think 2 or 3 months back, a series of videos. The first was released by Dr. Elizabeth Madam herself. And so we had been active in this front, and we will be continuing to be active and on this very important area. And once again, I congratulate IAP Thiruvananthapuram for arranging this event, and Dr. Elizabeth and Dr. Indu for taking the lead role in having this subspecialty group. Thank you all. Thank you for giving this opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Now we move on to the felicitations. May I call upon Dr. Sachidananda Kamath, National President, IAP 2015, to speak to us. Over to you,
thank
sir.
You. Thank you, madam. Good evening to you all. Chapter President, Dr. my dear friend, Dr. Ketan. Chief guest of the day, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, President-elect. State President, Dr. T.P. Jayaraman. Branch President, Dr. Santosh. And dear madam, Dr. Elizabeth, other dignitaries on the platform, my dear friends, senior colleagues. It's a real proud privilege for me to be here on this day, that is June 6th, the sixth day of the sixth month. That too pertaining to the current issue, current program, like what we had recently has been published, that Niti Aayog, when Kerala has been put into that first forerunner for the best in health indices and everything. But we should go through that documents, whatever it has been released, that we still have breastfeeding rate has come down. Complementary feeds have started earlier. Malnutrition is there. Standard growth is 20%. So these are all points together that even though we are having a good health indices as far as the All India is concerned, but Kerala still has to do many, many things more to reach to the better child. With this, I would say that better late than never. So it is the appropriate time that we have started now the complementary. And as the previous speakers were mentioned about, including the madam, that we should start. It is an art of feeding, how complementary feed has to be started and how it has to be introduced to the regular thing. With these words, I really appreciate the chapter who has given the permission to start the chapter in Kerala, and the leaders who have started this in Kerala, really appreciate them and wishing them all the success for every project which has been taken forward by the branch, Trivandrum branch, as well as Kerala State branch. Wishing you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you. May I invite Dr. Satish Tiwari, President, Human Milk Banking Association of India 2021, to felicitate. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, madam, for this opportunity. I thank the organizers of Kerala Working Group, and I must compliment Dr. Elizabeth, madam, to taking over this task of having a IP, IYCF chapter Kerala branch. Of course, the today's theme, 6th June, every year, and to be celebrated as the complimentary feeding day, is the brainchild of Dr. Elizabeth, madam. And everybody must compliment her for her vision and the mission in the future. So with this, I welcome all those who are there, the dignitaries on the dais. As far as the complementary feeding is concerned, we already discussed that it has to be started around 6 months of age. But unfortunately, the exclusive breastfeeding rate for 6 months are not improving in spite of all this. And either the complementary feeding is started earlier or it is started too late. Starting too late is our some of the myths that the breastfeeding can be adequate up to 1 year of age or from 9 to 12 months of age, especially in the rural or tribal population. And starting complementary feeding early is a biased or unscientific information by the media or by the multinational companies that you can start the baby with Ferrex or Cerelac around 6 months of age. So all this led to the confusion in the minds of the parents and the mother that it can be given earlier around 4 months or 5 months also. We also had a scientific recommendation that complementary feeding can be started around 4 months of age. And because of all this confusion, as Elizabeth Madam was saying, that around 4.5 months, the third dose of Penta and the polio, we are planning for the complementary feeding. But now with 6 months of age as a complementary feeding, these guidelines were very important. But as we said, the parents had a lot of confusion in the last few decades, and especially regarding the infant milk substitutes and the baby foods or the infant food. Now it is clearly written that it should be started after 2 years of age. But this confusion persisted till many years, that it has to be started around 4 to 6 months. So with all this biased and unscientific information, there was a lot of discussions, and then IMS Act came into force regarding the baby food or the infant food. So now there are clear-cut guidelines that any food should be started around 6 months of the age. In the morning, we discussed what is the difference between supplementary feeding and complementary feeding. Complementary feeding is to feed or to complement the breast milk, which already has all the advantages, but we are complementing around 6 months of age. While supplementary feeding is around any time when there is some deficiency in the food which the child is taking, or deficiency in the body, and that deficiency is corrected by supplementing the supplementary feed. So all this thing has to be taken into consideration. Though the IMS Act is there since 1992-93, many of us are either unaware of the IMS Act, or many of us are not following the IMS Act in words as well as in spirit. Because of this, there are many violations of IMS Act, and somewhere we have to stop all this. We have to keep on monitoring the violation of IMS Act. And as far as complementary feeding is concerned, we have to keep in mind the violation of giving infant food less than 2 years of age. So I think all our members will take up this responsibility of monitoring the IMS Act violation, report the monitoring to the IYCF chapter and to the central IIP, so that proper action can be taken and we can prevent this violation of the IMS Act. With this, I compliment again everybody, those who were instrumental in starting this complimentary feeding day. I must thank the central IIP leadership, the president, Dr. Piyush Gupta, and secretary, Dr. Basavaraj, who came out with excellent IYCF guidelines for the parents. I hope these guidelines are widely circulated to the parents and other groups, and it will help in preventing or minimizing the malnutrition in the Indian population, Indian children, and the future generation of our country. So thank you everybody again. Thanks for this opportunity. And let us hope that the maternal and child nutrition improves in the coming years. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have with us the immediate past president of IAP Kerala, Dr. M. Narayanan. Sir, request you to speak, sir.
Respected presidents, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, Dr. S.S. Kamath, Dr. T.P. Jayaraman, Dr. Kedan Bharadwa, Dr. Sadish Tiwari, Dr. Sandosh Kumar, Dr. Sri Prasad, Dr. Elizabeth Ma'am, and the one woman army, Dr. Indumati, and my dear seniors and friends in IAP Kerala and IAP Thiruvananthapuram. First of all, congratulations to IAP Thiruvananthapuram branch for choosing this day to launch a working group on complementary feeding. We all know that over the last few decades, 2-3 decades, Thiruvananthapuram has been the center for pediatric nutrition, whether it is for conducting conferences, workshops, or even printing books. Trivandrum has been taking the lead always. And my memories to 1989, that is nearly 31 years ago, Dr. Elizabeth ma'am used to tell the same words: feeding time should not be battle time. With the same enthusiasm, she's campaigning for correct nutrition, complementary feeding today also. So congratulations to the team for organizing this event and wishing this group all the best. One suggestion I have is that to propagate this message to the parents, to the public, we should utilize the social media, because that's the best method we can influence the parents and the public. So I know Trivandrum has got the immense capacity for making very good videos. So I suggest to make short videos on complementary feeding, so we'll be able to disseminate to the public. So that will be a major step in propagating our idea on complementary nutrition. Once again, thanking you for inviting me for this function. Thank you. Wish you all the best.
Thank you, sir. Now I request our State Secretary, IAP Kerala, Dr. Johnny Sebastian, to speak to us. Is Dr. Johnny with us?
Johnny is busy in a meeting, yeah, so he may not be coming. Oh,
in another meeting.
May I now request Dr. Riaz, National EB member of IAP, to speak to us.
Thank you, Dr. Anchu. Respected Elizabeth Madam, Kedan Ferdo sir, Somshega sir, Damesh sir, Jairam sir, Ajit sir, and the dignitaries here. It's indeed a pleasure being a part of launching the complimentary day. I always remember Elizabeth Madam's teaching. Madam, we usually fondly we call her the mother of child nutrition, and she always say complementary feeding is the safety net between the breastfeeding and family pot feeding. If that net is broken, the child will fall into the pit of malnutrition. This is something all of us carry in our heart, and with the help of Indumati Madam, now we are launching a special day and a special program for promoting complementary feeding. And I wish all the best for the program. And I think we will go on for the academic program. Over to Anju. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Riaz. We have our past state president, Dr. Mohammed Kunya sir, with us. Sir, would you like to speak a few words? Kunya sir? Okay, now we move on to the academic session. We now have a discussion on the topic sharing experiences.
Please,
Doctor.
Yes,
sir.
Muted. Muted.
Okay. Thank you. Dr. Elizabeth and all others for allowing me to be part of this program. Wish us all the best wishes for this program. And always, see, from our early MBBS days onwards, because feeding and children is a pet topic for me also. That is why I have joined. And I must again thank Dr. Indumati for inviting me for this program. And Indumati and Elizabeth, Anju, Sandosh and all others have done a wonderful job in organizing this program. Just like Down Syndrome Day, taking cues from Down Syndrome Day, this IVCN has taken June 6th as the day for the complementary feeding. It's a very good initiative. I think this must be, you must be organizing it for the first time, isn't it? Anyway, congratulations for the program. Wishing all the success. Thank you.
May I request Somashekaran sir, Secretary, IYCF chapter, to speak?
Uh, Good evening to all of you, respected President Ramesh Masi and the past president of the Kamat, sir, and every other dignitaries on the dais. It is indeed a great privilege and pleasure. The innovations always, you know, arise out of Kerala, whether it is teens life skill education or a CDC, the developmental screening, or whatever it may be, innovations comes out of Trivandrum. In that way, I'm really happy and proud. Here is a lady with a lamp. I convey my regards to Professor Dr. Elizabeth Madam. He is the Florence Nightingale of IYCF chapter for lighting up the lamps and giving a way for the complimentary feeding day. I think this will percolate into each and every one of our mindset in the near future, not to celebrate on this particular day, on this whole of this month and the future years to come, to prevent, as it was said, malnutrition, the national shame, will make it vivid and overt this and country free of malnutrition. And when we look at the BFHI, it was originated only from Kerala. And now, today, the statistics from 90%, the IYCF friendly from NFHS 3, it is from to NFHS 4, it has dropped to 60. There is a minus 30% decline. I don't know why it is the reason. So there are so many things which I think as a chapter, we need to work on it. I think there is a working group has been already formed in your state. I think this will bring out with the guidelines. And of course, we are very happy with the moment the central IAP headed by our academic guru, Professor Piyush Gupta, and Honorary Secretary General Piyush Gupta announced the day. And there are very many programs have been posted up and feeding, complimentary feeding guidelines and the counseling skill and so many things, activities are many across the country have been started working on this. And I thank each and everyone who has been involved, indebted to, committed to, disseminate this knowledge of complementary feeding, which is the need of the hour to strengthen the future generation, that is the children of India. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Now we have a panel discussion followed by an open forum. The topic for the discussion is sharing experiences on complementary feeding and the way forward. We have Dr. Priya Srinivasan, Associate Professor, GMC, Thiruvananthapuram, and Dr. Kristen Indumadi, Senior Consultant Neonatologist, SUT Hospital, as the moderators for the session. And the panelists for the discussion are Dr. Ashok Kumar G, Professor and Senior Pediatrician, KIMS Hospital, Thiruvananthapuram, Dr. Somashekar, Secretary, IAP, IYCF Chapter 2021, and EB Member, CIAP 2021, Dr. Ajit Krishnan, Professor and Head of the Department Pediatrics, Government Medical College, Thiruvananthapuram, Dr. Sri Prasad, President, IAP Alappuzha and Nutrition Chapter of Kerala 2021. Over to you, Indu Madam.
Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Can you see the slides also?
Yes, yeah. Ma'am. You may continue.
Go to slide show mode.
Yeah, ma'am. So at the outset, actually, I thank all of you for all your wishes. Respected presidents, dignitaries, senior colleagues, senior madams, and my dear friends. Actually, it was a great opportunity to work towards this day. During the COVID times, it was difficult, but I'm sure I had help from others also. But it was difficult, but it went through. Madam has already spoken about the theme. So as senior pediatricians and the working group, we are here to discuss some important things today so that we can form a group and go forward with some proceedings to work on it for Kerala. The Kerala figures, Madam is also now mentioning, and Shomashekar sir told us, we will be working. So the basic information, I would like to introduce the topic today and also see how the children are faring during this COVID times. In 2020, when we have some figures. So I will start with that and then we will go on to the questions. And Dr. Priya will also join me in the questions later. So initially, we'll just have some slides on malnutrition, how we're faring today. What do children die from? From the 1990s, definitely we have changed. This is our world in data. And you can see these boxes. These boxes are rectangles that correspond to the annual number of death under 5 years old. We have the deaths from pneumonia, diarrhea, preterm, neonatal disorders, and then we also have the nutritional disorders there. So definitely there is a death. How much is it? Undernutrition is associated with 45% of child deaths. It's a huge number. And sad to say, only 44% of children are breastfed, which is so simple a thing to do. And look at the levels and trends in child malnutrition. This is the 2021 edition, where you can see wasting is seen in 45.4 million. Overweight is seen in 38.9 million. This is the world. And 149.2 million are stunted still. Looking at the SDG goals, it's the time to act. By 2030, we are supposed to end all preventable deaths of newborns and children under 5 years, and aiming to reduce the neonatal mortality to low as 12 per thousand, and as under five mortality as low as 25 per thousand. To reduce the child mortality to at least as low as 2.5% in all countries. This would mean that more than 97.5% of newborns would survive the first 5 years of life. But we are very far away. We are currently far away from the goal for 2030. Globally, it's around 4% of all children die before reaching the age of 5, which means that an average 15,000 children die every day. That's a huge number. Now look at the graphs. The global overview, we have stunting, which has declined steadily since 2000, but faster progress is needed to reach the 2030 target. And we see that wasting persists at alarming rates, and overweight will have to have a reversal in trajectory. Most of the children with malnutrition live in Africa and Asia. If you look at the figures, 53% Asia and 41% Africa. So more than half of all the children under 5 are living in Asia, and 2 out of 5 live in Africa. More than 2/3 of all children under 5 affected by wasting live in Asia, and almost half of all the children under 5 affected by overweight. So we have the double or the triple burden of nutrition in our country. If you look at the progress towards the SDG, green tells you the progress. If you look at the green shadows in these graphs, only one quarter of countries are on the track. So that means some countries will never reach these targets, or we may reach only halfway through. So we still have to work our way through. The number of children with stunting is declining in all regions, but in Africa it is still to decline. So from 135.9 million, we have come down to 79 million. Whereas in Africa, it's actually gone up. And the numbers, wasting numbers affected, more than half of the children are living in Southern Asia. And look at overweight. Overweight is Southern Asia, Southeastern Asia, Northern Africa, the only sub-regions with significant increase in the number of children with overweight. So what does malnutrition do? Poor child growth in the first 1,000 days from conception to age predicts poor survival, increases the risk of obesity and other diseases, non-communicable diseases. It also reduces the cognitive and educational outcomes. And as Satish said, leads to income losses. So the World Bank is also looking into that. Stunted children may earn 20% less than the adults compared with their non-stunted peers. And stunting can reduce a country's gross domestic product by up to 3%. And not only that, this is difficult to reverse these things. And while cognitive deficits may be permanent after 2 years. So every child has a right to good nutrition, but less than 1/4 of children in this age group of 6 months to 23 months meet the criteria of dietary diversity and feeding frequency, which are appropriate for the age. Therefore, complementary feeding is not adequate. And 8,20,000 children's lives could be saved every year among children under 5 years if all the children were optimally breastfed and complementary feeding given. So with this overview, I'd like to ask Priya to take over now and go on with the panel discussion.
Thank you, madam, for giving me this wonderful opportunity to become the moderator. First of all, the questions are directed to Dr. Sri Prasad. Dr. Sri Prasad.
Madam.
Good evening and welcome to IAP Trivandrum.
Thank you, madam.
So my first question is, why is complementary feeding period considered as a critical period of opportunity for the health of an infant?
Before answering this, let me thank team Trivandrum IEP and the organizers of this first working group for considering me as one of the panelists to speak few words on complementary feeds. As Madam told, right to adequate nutrition is a fundamental right of every child. So as a pediatrician or as the member of IEP, we are committed not only to improve physical and mental health, but also to uphold the rights of the child. As we all know, maternal prenatal nutrition and the child's nutrition in the first 2 years of life, that is first 1,000 days, plays crucial factors in a child's neurodevelopment and lifelong mental health. So children who are fed enough of the right foods in the right way and the right time in their development are more likely to survive, grow, develop, and learn. They are better equipped to thrive even when faced with disease, disaster, or crisis. As we all know, complementary feeds should not be watery, and it can be solid, it can be semi-solid and soft. And we have to start complementary feed at the right time, that means after 6 months. And adequate in amounts, frequency, consistency, and using a variety of foods. So the foods should be prepared and given in a safe manner and be given in a way that is appropriate to the child. And definitely, we have to apply responsive feeding. That means you have to feed slowly, you have to feed patiently, don't force them. You can feed the infants directly, but at the same time, you have to assist the old children when they feed themselves. So remember, feeding periods are periods of learning and love. You can talk to the children during feeding with eye-to-eye contact. Complementary feeding means between the ages of 6 and 23 months. So this is the time where along with breastfeeding, the child is getting access to a diverse range of nutritious foods, providing essential nutrients, vitamins and minerals they need to develop to their full physical and cognitive potential with benefits that endure well into adulthood. So the complementary feeding period is also a critical opportunity to prevent all forms of childhood malnutrition, including stunting, wasting, micronutrient deficiencies, overweight, obesity, and all diet-related non-communicable diseases. In addition to this, lifelong food preferences, taste, and habits are often established in childhood. So, next slide, please, madam. Next slide. We can see that. Priya, madam, can you move to next slide?
Madam, Intumadi, madam.
So in most countries, declines in height for age occur primarily during the complementary feeding period due to inadequate quality or quantity of fast foods, poor feeding practices, and increase the rates of infection. So,
second question. Priya?
Yes.
Second question, you can go.
Yes. So, Sri Prasad, the next question is why at 6 months? We were talking about 6 month feeding. Why you have to start complementary feeding at 6 months and not earlier or later?
I am stopping my video because of low network. Is it okay?
That's okay.
Madam, after 6 months, there is a mismatch. As you know, till now, this 6x6 is well known to all of us because of Yuvraj Singh's six sixes in six balls. Now onwards, 6x6 is familiar to all IEP families because of this complementary feeding day. So after 6 months, but until 6 months, we can say that exclusive breastfeeding can promote all energy and nutrients for the baby. But after 6 months, there is a mismatch between supply and demand of energy and nutrients. Complementary feeding should be started at 6 months of age, because from the age of 6 months, an infant's need for energy and nutrients starts to exceed what is provided by breast milk, and complementary feedings becomes necessary to fill the energy and nutrient gap. So at 6 months, baby is biologically ready, because he holds his neck, he can hold his neck by the age of 4 months. The beating movement of jaw appears around 5 months. He develops hand mouth coordination and starts enjoying mouthing by this 6 months. And his intestinal amylase matures and gut becomes ready to accept cereals and pulses. His gums are getting hardened so that he can enjoy gumming semi-solid. And at the same time, tendency to push solid foods from the mouth decreases by this age. And if complementary feeds are not introduced at this age, or if they are given inappropriately, that means they are introducing before 6 months or after 6 months, and infant's growth may falter and also increases the risk and severity of infections like diarrhea and ARI. If breast milk is replaced by less nutritious food, it predisposes the child to malnutrition. And what is happening if you are starting, if you are introducing complementary feeds early? We know that breast milk can be replaced by complementary feeds. So the child will be less hungry. So he won't suck. Less suck means less production of milk. That means reduced production and less intake of breast milk. Next point is the duration of breastfeeding is shortened, and hence the advantages of breastfeeding to lactating mothers in terms of preventing new pregnancies are also reduced. There is an increased risk of diarrhea and food allergies due to immaturity of intestines that increases the risk of malnutrition. Early introduction of solid foods, especially legumes and protein-rich foods, increases the load on kidneys, and hence sodium and urea concentration of plasma might increase and put the infant to increase the risk of developing hypertension in adulthood. It interferes with the uptake of important nutrients found in breast milk, such as iron and zinc. So on the contrary, what will happen if you are introducing the complementary foods somewhat late? A late introduction of complementary foods can have detrimental effects on infant's growth and development, because as you know, the chances of rejection are more if you are introducing a new food at a later age. And at the same time, inadequate provision of energy and nutrients from breast milk alone may lead to growth faltering and malnutrition. The same thing with micronutrients. Micronutrient deficiencies, especially of iron, zinc, along with vitamin A and riboflavin, they can develop owing to the inability of breast milk to meet these requirements after 6 months of age. So the optimal development of motor skills such as chewing, tongue rolling reflex, and the infant's acceptance of new taste and textures may not be ensured if you are introducing late.
Okay. So the next question is, what are the barriers we face in implementing the safe and nutritious food?
As per me, the lack of knowledge is the predominant one, because some others believe that monitoring is not needed because now the child is growing okay. Because we all know that for the first few months, child is growing well, and for getting a visible malnutrition or visible undernutrition, it may take some months. For the same reason, as there are no complaints, the mothers are not that much bothered about the weight gain of the child. And they are saying, we have to take more care and start monitoring when the child has started eating solid foods. Means after 1 year or two. When a child is sick, you have to monitor. Or when a child is undereating or overeating, you have to monitor. So I think even in this era, lack of knowledge is the predominant one. And for the same reason, I think Kerala, the God's own country, has dropped 30% drop in complementary feeding rate as per Elizabeth Madam, as per her message now. And recently I had a baby. His mother started solid foods by the age of 3 months. Because every time she is saying that baby is crying, and I don't know what to do. And sometimes when I introduce some food, my baby likes the food because the child licks himself when you make them taste when I'm eating my own food. And child is giving a happy expression when the mother is dipping her finger into a curry and putting into the tongue of the child. And saying that my child is more happy and he's moving all his extremities well. And this means that child is fond of my curry and all. So another point I want to add here is, here the youngsters, many are depending on social medias, as Narayanan sir told. So they are receiving so many advices or messages from social medias and from surroundings, but at the same time they are really confused. You can see that when we are searching in a YouTube channel, most of the videos relating to the complementary feeds are not from doctors. They are from some professionals, because they are narrating well, they are presenting well. Because of that thing only, they are having a lot of subscribers, they are getting a lot of views. And I think I can't find a single video regarding complementary feeds in the first touch when I try to find a good video for complementary feeds. So many messages from the social media, that is another barrier. And another thing is that you can see that these commercial foods are available in the medical shop, in the supermarket, in the hospitals. So the availability of these products as an OTC product, over-the-counter product, may lead sometimes parents to buy this and to taste. But at the same time, many are not bothered about processing, and many are not aware of nutritive values of food. And they are easily available. Definitely social support is limited. We have to accept that. And always we are saying that it is the duty of the IAP. We have to do a lot in avoiding this barrier. Here we can work, here we can do a lot. I think we hope we can do something. And another barrier I am thinking, it is the poor self-efficacy for the maternal decision-making. And another one is influence of culture custodians. Because we know that the pre-lactial feeds, other culture problems, because many times when the mother is in dilemma, they will approach, many of the mothers are 21 or 22. They are many, when they are in dilemma, they are approaching their elders, their neighbors, even though they don't know anything, they will give a detailed explanation what to do, what to give, what to eat. And I don't know, many of the times, all are starting with biscuits, especially arrowroot biscuits. I don't know. It is a phenomenon all over the ALP, and maybe I think all over the Kerala. I don't know. And I know a baby who has given a complete egg at the age of 4 months, because as per her grandmother, all they belongs to like a bodybuilding family. So at the age of 4 months, you can eat, or her baby can eat, one full egg. And from the other side, many of the mothers are getting tired because of the overload and other duties, because she has to take care of other children, she has to take care of laundry and all, she has to work, she has to take care of gardening and all. And I think because of the fatigueness, some are reluctant to continue breastfeeds till at least until 2 years of age. This is my opinion, madam.
Okay, thank you, Sri Prasad. So summarizing why this is a critical period because feeding should be optimized during this period. All nutrients will not be met after 6 months of age by the breast milk. So you have to optimize the physical, the growth of the baby as well as the cognitive development of the baby so that the baby attains its full human potential. So that is one thing regarding the critical period, and we should prevent all kinds of malnutrition. And the lifelong food preferences regarding the taste and habits, all these develop during this complementary feeding period. So that is regarding the critical period which Sri Prasad was talking to. And next is regarding the 6 months. Why at 6 months? That is the baby is developmentally ready and the breast milk does not suffice. That is, there will be an energy gap, there will be a protein gap and a micronutrient. That is an iron gap, vitamin A, zinc. So there will be a gap and that need to be corrected. So regarding the barriers, it is mainly the awareness among the mothers. That is, we have to take care of it. That is, we should teach the mothers, the even the healthcare workers also we should teach so that they are the ones who are who will be in contact with the mothers very often. And we should also take into consideration the working mothers also. So that is one major concern, that is what the working mother should do, because these maternity leaves and all is there till 6 months. So after 6 months, actually, the problem starts. The very complicated process of this complementary feeding starts after 6 months, actually. So we should have some kind of policy regarding this, extending this maternity leave or something like that. Okay, thank you, Sri Prasad. Over to you, Madam Indumati, Madam.
So next, I'd invite Professor Dr. Somashekar, sir. So there are three questions. I think they're more related, so I will just go through them. Does it matter to give age-appropriate nutrient-rich foods? Or we can give every same food for all the children? What and when should children eat, and what is responsive feeding? Over to you, sir.
Madam, it does matter, because it matters too much even too. Because as the child is in growing, the velocity of growth must be matched with adequate supply in terms of quality as well as frequency and the quantity. So we have a three breakup. As you know that the protein is the bodybuilding, which forms the basis. There have been studies and the data, if the protein which is inadequate, the baby who will eat, growth faltering is very much advanced, and even less than 1 year old baby can have a growth faltering due to protein deficiency. So it does matter to give age appropriate complementary feeding. This is the need of the hour, in fact. So after Sri Prasad has brought out that very beautifully, why we should start only after 6 months. So it should be after the completed 180 days, it should be started. To start with, from 7th month onwards, it should be a thick porridge. It should not fall slippery from the spoon when you take. Contrary to that, our customs and beliefs, our mothers, when we say you give khichdi, idli, upma, porridge and things like that, so on and so forth, they say, is it that you are, you joking, doctor? They say like that. Rather, they'll give it, you know, like in a grinder, they mix it well and give it in the form of a liquid. This we need to tell them that we should not, it should be the consistency matter. This is what the texture. So when you take it in the spoon, it should not fall down. It should form a tongue-like shape, like it should not fall down and should not slip. That is why the complementary feeding is a slippery slope. So we should not slip off. We should see that the, although the food texture should not slip off, okay? So start with a thick porridge, well-mashed food, whatever homemade, it should be fresh. And 2 to 3 times per day, plus continuing the breastfeeding ad libitum. And how much to give? To start with 2 to 3 tablespoons. That's all. To start with small quantity, slowly and steadily. Anything, any food, the mother say, it, when I try to push it, the baby spits. It is common that the reflex is there, the baby tends to spit initially. Then you keep on giving anything which you offer. I'll tell the mother, saying that when you go, see, your husband worked in so many other countries, they eat all sort of things, and when you go there, how will you start? So this is how you start. The 3 years, you must remember, when we say the texture, the quality and quantity. See, this is another 3 years we remember, is the small quantity, and slowly and steadily we must increase. Then when it comes to the 9 to 11 months, it is the finely chopped, because the baby tend to reach out with the sensor crop being developed. It tend to reach out and it enjoys, you know, the, all of us know the baby led feeding, and there'll be initially a gag reflex tend to bring it out. And then now the baby started accepting. It's also starts, you know, exploring, tend to give whatever it offers into the mouth. This is an opportunity. We should grab it. So starting from 9 months, 11 months, you should give a finely chopped food that baby can pick up and eat. How much to give? What is the frequency? The frequency must be increased from 2 to 3 times to 3 to 4 meal, plus continuing breastfeeding. And if you want, you can give a mid-morning and mid-evening can be added along with 3 times. That is 3 plus 1. Your one snack can be given. One snacks can be given. It should not be a filling material like. So it should not give a filling like. So what is the quantity you advise and advocate? It is from 125 ml. It should be increased to half katori or half bowl or a half cup. That is amount to 250 ml. This is what is important, that the, gradually it should be increased for the velocity of the growth to match with. And then after 1 year, this is a very critical, crucial period. Child starts playing, tends to, you know, eat along with it. The separate meal plate must be like to enjoy the feeding time. So it should be a fun time, as madam has said. So family pot feeding, it should never be pushed, and it should be, you know, baby must be made to eat on his or her own. This is very, very essential, that how much to give. The 50% of the family diet, whatever we eat, must then, by then the baby must have learned to take all the family food, whatever we eat. This is important, that the culture, the traditional belief that this should be given, that should not be given like that. Never, no such partitions, that even including if there is a non-vegetarian, whatever the traditional belief, locally, culturally acceptable, the homemade, freshly prepared with hygienic weight should be given. And how much to give, the frequency must increase to the same 3 to 4 times, but depending on the appetite. This is what is the response if it comes. I think Madam Indumati will bombard me with the next question of what is to reiterate that comes to, you know, 6 to 9 months, it is 3 times. And what to give is the forage and fruits, and the fruit diversity must be there. As I said, the groups of food, that is the grams, that is the greens, and it is the vegetables, that is the dark green leafy vegetables, and it is the grapes, that is the another 4th G, and the 5th G is the ghee. That is what I meant, the food plate should have the food diversity. The next slide, you see here, the increase to 9 to 12 months, it increased to 3 to 4 times. And the same food which has to be given in a modified and varied way, that the child should, you know, like eat by him, made to eat, and it should be fond of, you know, handling the food and using the utensils and so on and so forth. And the next slide is that you can see the food plate, which I have said, it is the 5G. Now people are talking, increasing the G to 2G, 3G, 4G. Now it is, I focus upon the 5G, only you can get the safety net, protective safety net and a good internet like that. The 5G, what is 5G? The grains and the grams and the greens and the grapes, that is fruits, and the other G is the ghee. This is what is important. The child between 12 to 23 months should receive 3 to 4 meals, as I said earlier. It is a family food. Depending on the child's cues, that you should understand the cues and when to stop. The child also gives a hunger cue, its fullness cues. And this is the food diversity, that how much quantity it should be focused upon, how much cereal and millets, how much is the pulse, and how much is the milk. quantity, and it should consist of roots, tubers, and DGLVs, and the vegetables and fruits, and sugar less than 12 months. No, it should be only from the natural source. No added sugar. It can be added only after 1 year. That is only limited to 25 grams. When you look at the fat and oil, it is much more needed, because you are giving oil only to 10, ml, but here you are increasing to 100. So this is what is the important of calorie dense diet. The same thing, but you add on with the oil, make the calorie density. This is important. The next thing is about the responsive feeding. I think the monitoring, whatever we do, the growth monitoring, two monitoring, which I say, one is the IMS Act monitoring, not to violate from the people tend to, after 6 months, tend to give all commercially food, and the working mother prefer to rather give a junk food. I will say the junk will make the baby mentally funk. So junk is funk. So please note down, no junk food at any point of time. And for a better growth, you should give only the co-mobile fluids. And the food must be, as I said, from 6 months to end of 6 months to 23 months should have followed the principle of having got the fatwa, that is the 6 steps which you should look into. It should be adequate in frequency. The amount must be how much it should be, and how many times it should be given, and what is the consistency, and the variety, of course, diversity must be there, and it should be actively fed with the responsive reciprocal in way, and depending on the hunger cues and the behavior of the baby as well as the parents and the caregivers. And of course, not to forget every food to be prepared. We have learned quite a lot of things about hand washing, and not to forget, this is the most important component of the feeding, complementary feeding. So while feeding, the mother should communicate well with the baby. And then I'll stop with that.
Okay, sir. So thank you, sir, for nicely telling us about what is age appropriate and feeding, and also increasing slowly frequency and continuing the breastfeed, and responsive feeding is very important. Thank you for that. 5G, sir, we will remember that. And combining all this diversity of food is very important. And so thank you, sir, for those wisdom, pearls of wisdom. Next
question you ask, you must ask me what is responsive feeding.
Yes, I had to ask you actually, yeah. But anyway, please tell us about responsive feeding.
No, you have not asked me.
Okay, so in the beginning I had asked. You can tell us, sir.
Okay. See, as I said, the response, there are two types of feeding. One is the responsive feeding, one is the non-responsive feeding. So anything when I say you responded, so I'm also responding. The response feeding is the need of the hour. It is a two-way process and reciprocal relationship that involves the child giving a cue. The many of you may not know. Starting from hunger cues, I used to tell them, it is not the baby you must feed only after the crying. It has three cues. It gives signaling, like, so the signal for either hunger also it gives, and when the baby gives, the fullness also, doesn't want also, will give a keep the mouth, shut, that you should not push that time. This is what is the, depending on the cues we need to respond to. The parents noticing the child cues, the acute interpretation of the sign, that is very important. Responding to that sign in an appropriate way is what is known as the responsive feeding. So what is non-responsive feeding then? The non-responsive feeding is one that the parents, have a controlled feeding. Like, see, it should also, the parents or the caregiver will have a control. What to give, how to, want, when to, what time to eat, this is what you must eat, this not to eat. Like that, they have a, ignoring the cues. That is controlled parents, the non-responsive parents, controlled parents will nevertheless look into the cues at all. They are rather very busy in their way. So, and it, what happens at the end? It results in, the stressful behavior, the stressful behavior of the family as well as the mother and the parents, and the entire family members are stressed up. This, I think most of the time we must have noticed that the husband who comes calls from the over office that what you are giving. So the baby is not eating anything. Then the mother, then he will shout from there, what, you don't know what to give, how to give, and you are very fool. Like that, she gets the, you know, like very bad words from her, you know, better off. So this is what is happening. So all of you must remember that the baby must be fed responsibly, and non-responsive leads to conflicts and, you know, family, it spoils the family relationship. And the behavior and practice of the parents and family is very important. And we should, it rather gives, you know, like a stimulation. The baby is developing, the early, you know, child development, it should touch upon the emotions as well. You should care as, you must sing. When we say that, Nila Choru, see, they'll look at the sky and show the old moms, you know, grandpas, they used to sing a song and feed. And so much so we have learned, and no mother has got the patience now. This is very, very important that each child should be fed with supervision and separate plate and develop an individual identity. This is what I said in the morning, that when a child around 1.5 years does not eat anything at home, you take the child to any restaurant, and the child is, as soon as the child is, you know, in the lap of the mother, the attendant who's there in the hotel, who just give your high-rise chair, and the baby is made to sit in that chair, and the child feels that he has become a king. He's empowered to eat. He's right to eat now. So that is how the child has been greeted when he goes to the, gets to the place. And the dosa, which he never eats at home, is pitchify and throw it away into pieces. When the dosa is made to stand like a pyramid, and the hotel, the texture is changed, and he gets the cues that he eats and finish off one full dosa in the pyramid dosa when it is made to stand. This is what happens. The force feeding leads to aversion, and always I say that the fourth Newton's law will set in. When it tries to force feed, it leads to aversion. It rather starts spitting and try to, you know, make the mother, who's become more anger by spitting onto her face. So proper feeding habits, the baby is learning by responsive feeding. Along with feeding, the mother also gives, you know, provide a psychosocial stimulation, and the child through ordinary age-appropriate play. This is also very, very important. He is play, the play which stimulates in all the domains and the cognitive developments and the other developments, every domain the child gets early child development by means of adapting to responsive feeding. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Over to Priya.
Thank you, madam. Sir Rajit Krishnan, sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, Rajit Krishnan, sir, is my own HOD. The first question is, what is an adequate diet during complementary feeding?
Actually, both the questions are connected. So I will answer both in my presentation. First of all, let me thank Elizabeth Madam and the nutrition chapter officials and the IAP to give me this opportunity. As Dr. Riaz also pointed out, we even have in our mind all the teachings that our great Elizabeth Madam has taught us. Because after that, there is a definite gap in the teaching about nutrition. We are remembering only, as he said, the pit of, you'll fall into the, unless you walk very carefully through the bridge from breastfeeding to the family pot feeding, you will fall into the pit of malnutrition. That pit of malnutrition is definitely all in our mind. Another thing is the tip of iceberg. As she said, we are seeing the severe acute malnutrition cases quite often than previously. In less than 6 months and even above 6 months also. But definitely the prevalence of undernutrition in under fives is definitely much more higher. I don't know whether in Kerala the severe acute malnutrition as well as the protein energy malnutrition in under fives is on the increase. Anyway, this my presentation maybe after two excellent talk my presentation I think that most of them are overlapping and maybe something repetition. Anyway, I will go through that. The feeding during 6 to 23 months, that is the first 2 years of life, and especially after the initial exclusive breastfeeding from 6 months, is really a challenging time to meet the nutritional demands. And it's an important determinant of child survival, growth, development, micronutrient deficiencies, and of course, an important cause for recurrent infections in this age group. Maybe a prevalence of increasing prevalence of protein energy malnutrition, and it will also lead to increasing morbidity, especially the lifestyle diseases in adult life, like hypertension, obesity, diabetes. So it's a very important, the feeding during the first 2 years of life is very, very important. And the quality, quantity, and poor feeding practices determines the nutritional adequacy. The quality should be very important. That is, it should be meeting the, it should have the good quality protein, and the energy should be adequately met. And, okay, next slide. Of course, this is a infant and young child feeding practice guidelines. So actually, Priya is also, I want to do a study on this thing, whether the WHO, these objectives, that the objectives of infant and young child feeding practices is met in our children. We have to actually, after the initial immunization, there is a long gap up to 1.5 years. So even though you are getting one immunization at 9 months, there is a long gap, and I don't know whether the people are frequently monitored for growth, as well as whether we are giving nutritional advice, whether their surveillance is there for nutrition. We have to think about it. So definitely, there is a lack of communication between the pediatrician and the children of this age group. So the objectives are early breastfeeding less than 1 hour, exclusive breastfeeding up to 6 months, then introduction of solid, semi-solid, soft foods 6 to 8 months, and minimum, you should keep these objectives, minimum diet diversity, minimum meal frequency, and minimum acceptable diet. That was already been told by Somashekhar sir, and continued breastfeeding to 12 to 23 months. Next slide. So are we meeting these objectives? So this is the percentage of children benefiting from infant and young child feeding. See, when you look at this, each of these objective, so even though we are talking very much about BFHI, still, even in Kerala, I think there is the only very less number of newborns are fed within the first hour of life. Usually, it will take more than five. We have done a study in Kollam Government Medical College. We found that there is more than 50% of the children are still not fed within 1 hour, and some are fed with other things. And the WHO also shows the similar observations. So the exclusive breastfeeding also, half of them are not receiving exclusive breastfeeding. And the introduction of most of them, that is 2/3 of children are introducing the semi-solid foods. The complementary feeding is getting started at 6 months, but they are not given the proper food. That is the food minimum food frequency, minimum food diversity, and the minimum the required feed is not given. That is, in only 1/3 of children are getting the minimum diet diversity and minimum adequate food. And the continued breastfeeding, the 2/3 of children are getting continued breastfeeding. So there is definitely a lot of children, most of the children are not meeting the objectives of the infant and young child feeding. Next slide. So what do you mean by an adequate diet? The adequate diet during complementary feeding period should be nutrient rich, without excess energy, saturated and trans fats, and free sugars and salt. So there should not be an excess energy and saturation and trans fat and free sugars. There should not be any added sugars. And dietary diversity is already have been taught, and there should be a dietary diversity, nutrient density, because there is a small stomach, and actually when compared to that, is a child is having a higher energy and protein demand. So the nutrition food should be dense foods, and the inclusion of animal source foods should be definitely there, because it will give a good quality protein and essential fatty acids. Both are required for the growth of the body and the brain. And the vegetables and fruits should definitely be included in the diet, because it will give the vitamins, minerals, and the micronutrients. And of course, sometimes if for some reasons you are not able to meet these requirements, there is you should always supplement with the vitamin and mineral supplements. Next slide. So what children should do eat? So this has already been taught by Somasekhar sir, so I am not going into the details. A diet should expose to different taste, as already mentioned. The child should expose to different taste and texture of foods, and animal food should be included. And foods like fish, nuts, seeds, and soybeans, which contains a polyunsaturated fatty acid, should be included. And fruits and green leafy vegetables. So these are all things that I have told. The importance is that there is a diversity of food should be there, and that is very important to meet all the required nutrients of the child. Yes. So this food should be avoided. That is food and beverage of no nutrient value. Candy, chips, high in sugar, salt, fats, all these things like processed foods, all these things should be avoided. And there should be no added sugar and salt. This oil and sugar and salt is only for in a very small quantity as required. There should not be any added oil, and should not be any added sugar and salt. And the processed foods you should not take, because there is increase in trans fatty acids, and it is containing salt and excess of fat. Yes, next. So this is and just emphasizing what Somasekhar sir has told. There is a timely introduction of first foods starting from 6 months, then age appropriate meal frequency starting from a low frequency, so 2 to 2, that has also been discussed. Age appropriate amounts and age appropriate food consistency, safe preparation, storage and use, responsive feeding, that also sir told, and feeding during illness, that is very important. So usually that is as madam used to tell, so it's a vicious cycle. So infection lead on to malnutrition, and malnutrition again leading on to illness. So during illness, there should be an extra amount of energy and protein to give the child. Yes. Next slide. So the balance diet. That is
the
So cereals, green leafy vegetables, fruits, then dairy products, and then animal foods like meat, fish, egg alternatives, and as I told, the fat, oil, salt and sugar should be the minimum. Next slide. So this is regarding the determinants of infant feeding. So they should get adequate foods, they should have the adequate services and adequate practices, then only you will get good food. Next slide. So what adequate foods, there should be availability, accessibility, and affordable. The patient should be affordable. So the low, the food that is available which is having good nutritive value should be told to the mother. And adequate services, that is use of health and nutrition services. That is the mainly ICDS program, where we are giving curative and preventive health care and nutrition services, nutrition supplementation, nutrition monitoring and nutrition education. So all these things are available in primary health centers and the ICDS Anganwadis. And then health quality of the health and nutrition services. That is also very important. Not only it should be available, but it should be the given quality of care to these children. And then use of social protection services. They will increase the food proper food purchasing power and food security, especially in this COVID time. So the use of social protection services will enable these children to get adequate food. And then the use of water and sanitation services, and then adequate practices, the caregiver knowledge and time. They should be knowing the caregiver, whoever it is, the mother, usually they will go for a work, and sometimes they will not get time in their house because they are the main, mainly engaged with work. So the care should have knowledge about the type of foods, then the, and she should spend some time in household dynamics. That is also very important. That is, there is the distribution of food in the house, like any preference, food preference, genetic preferences. So all these things, gender preferences, other, and all these things. So these are the determinants of the food availability to these children. Next.
Thank you.
Next slide. Thank you.
Thank you. Priya? Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Ajit Krishnan, for very nicely telling us about the appropriate food habits and the determinants, which are actually a major cause for the for the deficiency in complementary feeding. Next, we go on to our professor Ashok Kumar sir, who's a very senior pediatrician and professor, KIMS Hospital, Trivandrum. Sir is got a lot of experience in complementary feeding, and sir Ashok Kumar sir, we invite you to give your experience.
Thank you,
sir. Can some questions which I wanted to ask you? Can children be fed during the illness? And many mothers prefer commercial food preparations than home-based preparation. What is your opinion? How do you counsel mothers on that?
Okay, at the outset. I congratulate Elizabeth, who is a mother of nutrition education. I wonder how Indumati got interested in complementary feeds. She's a famous, popular neonatologist, but it's very good that Indumati got interested in complementary feeds, and I was complimenting her. Whatever she touches becomes gold. So congratulations to Elizabeth and Indumati. I was very much interested in nutrition when I was asked to choose as an MD student my own topic for MD thesis, and I chose infant feeding practices in semi-urban Pondicherry, and I did a good work, I was told. Then I attended this, I had a 3-month course in nutrition in National Institute of Nutrition also. I was very much interested in this topic of nutrition. Coming to this special question, today's question, can children be fed during illness? Children should be fed during illness, of course, otherwise they will starve to death. But what is special? During illness, their nutrition requirements are more actually. Because of the fever and all those things, metabolic rate is more, they need more calories. And another thing is, depending upon the illness, tissue injury may be there, and for the repair, they need more nutrients of protein and vitamins. So children should be fed actually more during illness, but there are limitations. Children usually have loss of appetite during illness. Yes, viral illness, we know that they are very reluctant to take food. So they sometimes have to be force fed. Sometimes there is a severe vomiting. So we may have to resort to intravenous feeding and all those things. So children have to be fed during illness. The children have to be fed extra. But giving solid foods or thick semi-solid foods may be not practicable. So give light semi-solid foods. Like in Kerala, we have got this kanji, rice gruel, which is very popular and very acceptable to the mothers also. So kanji water or kanji gruel or rice gruel. It's very popular. We can advise, easily available in the house also. So we ask them to give it to the sick child. And they should be given more water, more calories also. We can give fruit juices. Usually we say fruit juices should not be a common diet item in childhood, or because one thing is empty calories mostly, except some vitamin C, and a lot of sugar is also added. So empty calories. So, but during sickness, we should relax our rules a little bit. We can give lime juice. Kerala, we have got coconut. So coconut water is easily available. Coconut water we can give. Vegetable soups we can give. They are very good. And Italy also, I think it should become an international food actually. It's one of the best complementary food invented by the South Indians for the world, I think. It's a mixture of cereals and urdu dal, rice and urdu dal, steam cooked, very soft, very tasty, very easily chewable. So they can be given Italy. And another thing which I wanted to stress was the type of the feeding technique also is important. When we were small children, we used to be fed with the complementary fed lying supine on these outstretched legs, lower limbs of the grandmothers or mothers. But that was the practice in Kerala. But now we are changing. So many times we have found that children choke and aspirate when they lie supine on the leg and take food. So we have to properly advise the feeding technique. So many cases of recurrent respiratory infection I could prevent by proper counseling regarding the position of holding the baby when feeding the semi-solids. So first question is, children should be fed more. Sometimes these so-called banned items like ice creams. Would anybody advise ice creams for babies? No. So some bigger child or 1 year or 2 year had extensive stomatitis and refused to take anything because whatever their child takes, it has got a burning taste in the mouth. So then one pediatrician said has to be tube fed, and the parents could not think of tube feeding a very active, otherwise very active child. So I said, try some ice cream, and they gave ice cream, and temporarily we could tide over the crisis. And from next day, the ulcers started healing and the child could accept usual food. So sometimes we have to think a little bit differently and give so-called banned foods like ice creams. Fruit juices I usually don't advise to children because they are empty calories, but during an acute crisis of fever, fruit juice may be a good thing. Lime juice I said already, coconut water I told already. Second question, many mothers prefer commercial food preparations. Very wrong actually, we should not. Actually, we Kerala is ruled by communist ministry and we are against anything international or multinational. We cannot sometimes, what about our vaccines? What about so many things we have to use a multinational preparation? So it's not correct to be very dogmatic. Sometimes we have to use commercial food when the mother is, now everybody is sitting at home because of the lockdown or working off online. So otherwise the mothers may not have time or the know-how how to prepare a food gruel, semi-solid food like ragi or raw banana powder, how to make it, especially in a nuclear family. In a joint family, the grandmothers would teach them, but in a nuclear family, they may not have the time or the know-how how to produce this. But in exceptional situations, I think commercial food can be given, but always homegrown or locally available grains and cereals and legumes are much better. We should include potatoes are very good. Carrots mashed, well-boiled or mashed potatoes and carrots, they are very good. I always tell Elizabeth in our personal talks that something like biscuits should be invented, because the children need 6 feeds a day actually. They cannot have 3 meals like us. They need 6 meals. So in between, what do you give? So something like biscuits. Biscuits, the problem is made of maida, which is not good for children. So if we can devise, or we can ask the food research organization in Mysore to devise some special nutritious biscuits which do not have maida, maybe made of whole wheat, and which do not have harmful additives or preservatives. Advantage of biscuits are that they are stored easily, have long shelf life, portable, and small packets they can buy, and the children also enjoy it. But the conventional biscuits I won't advise, but if special biscuits we can get done by the Food and Nutrition Food Research Organization Mysore, where whole wheat biscuit can be food made without adding harmful additives or preservatives, I think this would be a good thing. Another thing which I wanted to ask, however much we calculate the calories, it's very difficult to make 800 or 1,000 calories for a baby. So we have to devise some way to make up the calories. It's a big calorie graph. Otherwise, what happens is the proteins which we give will be broken down and used for calories. So children will be undernourished. So ghee is a good thing, which is, we can popularize. Oils are good. So I always tell them pappadam, puppets fried in oil is a good thing. Vada, ulunnu vada, which we call, like Urdu dal vada, which is now, I think, South Indian food again now has become popular all over India. They are good. So protein plus fat, they give good calories. So we have to think out of the box. So we have to do something to reduce the calorie gap. Otherwise, whenever I calculate the calorie, it doesn't reach 800 or 1,000 calories required by the baby. That's all. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you for sharing your knowledge and experience. We're really grateful for that. I think that's the end of our questions. So we should, as a working group, I think we should go ahead and provide some solutions to this problem. And there's time to improve. And some of the action to improve is suggested by the WHO already, like counseling, social behavior changes, education of the mothers, all these things are already said. And how much are we going to do is the question. And will the mothers have access to affordable and nutritious foods also? So taking into account that all of this, I just wanted to bring this picture to you. Action framework to improve the diets of young children. This is also from the WHO. Now that we know the analysis, situation analysis, the determinants, adequate food services and practices, and the food system, the health system, the water sanitation, and the social protection system, all of them have to come together to provide the good diets for the children. So with our level of intervention from the IAP, with actions at the policy level, institution, public and private level, and also passing this on to the mothers, the community level, I'm sure, and frequent monitoring and evaluation and learning will help us to bring good diets to our young children. And therefore, I take this opportunity of thanking Elizabeth Madam once again for starting this whole thing, and thanking for including me. As sir said, I'm a neonatologist, but my passion is also community medicine. So I also interested in community work. So that is how I got into nutrition also. Thank you for all the advices and thanks once again. So hope we will do the best for the children.
I think there is a question in the chat box that is about the Amritam mix. I think as pediatricians, we have a reservation regarding the Amritam mix for infants below 1 year or less than even 10 months. The government is promoting that it has got multiple items. And according to our concept and advice, it should be item by item, it should be added. And as Dr. Prashant has mentioned, there is a lot of sugar in it. So that is another thing, like the health drinks, just to give 10 gram of protein, there will be 50 gram of sugar in it. So why do we want to give 50 gram of sugar when we are aiming at giving protein for the child? Why can't we choose something which is natural? That is my plea to that. So I always tell them, don't start at 6 months with this multiple items. But maybe it can be given when we diagnose malnutrition. Maybe we want to give more energy and protein, we can give it. Or to a baby who already has been accustomed to cereals, pulses, and multiple nutrients, then it can be given. That is my advice.
I think, thank you, madam, for that advice. Priya, you have to say anything? I think the time is past. Yeah, actually, we wanted to invite at least some things from the open, just like an open forum now. People can comment on this and how much we can contribute to improving our complementary feeding.
Indu?
Yes, sir.
This social welfare, mother and child welfare department, they have got this, all these Anganwadi workers are under them. So I think we should collaborate with them.
Yes.
Whatever we decide and whatever we can, we should collaborate with them. And maybe even Amritam we can modify according to our scientific knowledge. And they will disseminate our knowledge into the community because they are a lot of children, one to above 1.5 or 3 years, 2 years children are going to the Anganwadi. And another important thing is weight monitoring. Without monitoring, how do we know there is subclinical malnutrition? Yes. So there should be an occasion to monitor with a good weighing machine. At 6 months, they should be, even if they are not, they should be called for a review at 6 months for a well baby clinic checkup. 9 months, we call for a measles vaccination. 1 year we can call them, and 15 months, 18 months, and then at 2 years. So every 3 months, I think we should call them. And if there is any weight faltering, we can give proper advice, corrective advice to the mothers.
Thank you, sir. Then, madam, would you like to say something, madam?
I was always recommending to them, you make two type of Amritam mix junior for 6 months, and then another one for the toddler. Well taken, sir.
Elton, madam, please.
I think nothing much to contribute because we have heard almost a lot, but just I would like to congratulate Elizabeth and of course Intu and Priya for organizing such an excellent day. As usual, I think Elizabeth has come out with another program in relation to the nutrition. And this, I'm so happy, or even sometimes on a lighter way, and I envy Elizabeth for maintaining this temper of interest in nutrition. And of course, now dragging Hindu and Priya to continue her work in nutrition. Hats off to you, Elizabeth.
Thank you so much. You are also a role model for us.
Yes, ma'am.
You are one of the pioneer, madam.
Just one thing that is, I think all said and done, especially in the COVID time, I think there is a significant role played by the electronic media for parents used to feed the child. All said and done, I think almost 70% of the mothers use some sort of a media like either a TV or a phone to feed their children, even though we say that strictly no screen time, no media. Maybe I don't know what we can do for that. It may be the stress of the mothers.
Nothing could be done, madam. I am also seeing the screen and feeding myself.
Yeah, right. But it's very, very difficult.
Madam, actually, what I suggest is at least we can tell them what to show to the children. We can at least choose right. something more wiser, because telling a complete no is actually not practicing, not practical.
It's not at all practice. All said and done, it is not at all practice, especially now.
We can show our theme song.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. That's
yes, I want to see Meera. Meera for such beautiful song. Is Meera working in CDC now? Is the same Meera?
Yes, sir. She's doing it.
Oh, she was my faculty, you know, Gogulam. That's right.
Oh, okay, good. Wonderful song, actually. It really rings in the ears. It's very nice.
Thank you.
And regarding this Amritam, madam, actually, this Women and Child Welfare Department will be happy to take our suggestions, because they themselves were conducting a few surveys to see whether the Amritam energy content and protein is adequate or not. So I think if IVCN chapter approaches, because they do conduct many programs with IAP Trivandrum, so we can approach them, madam.
Yeah, junior Amritam should be there, because I know something is given from the Anganwadi, the parents are also accepting it.
But hey, you wanted right to ask something, Priya?
But at the right time, you should also declare our next IVCN IVCN con. Where it is, when it is, with whom. I said with Tamil Nadu and Kerala put together, joined together, we can do, madam, this time. This is going to be a virtual only, I think. Am I right, sir? Now our president Ketan also here.
So madam, I think this working group will have we should have some proceedings out of this and try to form some things.
Take the proceedings and submit.
Go about how to improve, madam, the complementary feeding rates. So involving health workers. Priya wanted to ask also for the health workers to be involved. And what is the anticipated time you'll have to give the guidance to the mothers. These things are there. So unless we do all these things, I don't think we can improve. So
I just started. I was wondering whether we should teach the healthcare worker how to plot the weight for length chart or the weight for height chart. Also,
some app which will calculate it. They have some access to some app, but we will have to see whether everybody is using it.
Yes, madam, because that is how we have defined this malnutrition as well as obesity, overweight.
To type it into the tab or their phone and an app is doing it. I think we'll have to meet the minister and the new team and tell them about it. Riyas can also help us, Dr. Kunyu can help, Dr. Rajmohan can help.
And again, regarding the anticipatory.
Priya, one suggestion.
Yes.
In our attempt to correct undernutrition, we should not push them to overnutrition.
Yes, sir.
Overnutrition is a bigger problem. Ask Riyas.
Very true.
It's a very big problem and very difficult to correct also. Once they become very fat, it's very difficult to bring down the obesity. Mm. So obesity is better prevented than corrected. So yes. In our attempt, I always wonder whether 50th percentile is the ideal, or even because even BMI, we said 23 is ideal for Indians, not 25. So even so, we should decide whether 50th centile or even 30th centile or 35th centile is good enough to prevent a future lifestyle diseases. We have to think.
True, sir. Absolutely true. Actually, we have to monitor children and prevent obesity, because when we plot the weight chart of children who come with obesity, we can very well see that there was a point when these children were absolutely normal and were having normal weight, and they usually gain this weight over a period of years. and we have a lot of opportunity to intervene there. And it is because we don't look at the weight in that manner. We usually see the weight for calculating the dose only, and parents also don't look at it. So we identify obesity only when they become visibly obese. So we need to monitor and we need to intervene early. And sir, regarding the new BMI charts from IAP also, they are not looking at 50th centile or 75th centile. They are actually looking at the equivalence of the 23 adult values. So I think we can use those BMI charts for children who are more than 5 years. And below that, as Dr. Priya told, we can use the weight for height chart. So that will be good.
It's very good to hear Ashok Kumar sir after a long time, especially with the so many out of box ideas.
Madam, actually, we missed him speaking to us as the Omenamathi Madam orator. Yeah, right. So we were planning for that, and then this COVID surge came. So we will have it once the things are better, man.
I still remember he's so fond of biscuits from those days. A compliment.
That is what I was telling Priya also. We must call sir to talk.
Just now I am having biscuits in front of
him. Yeah. He's already meeting, sir. He's already meeting that.
Yeah. Would you like to conclude?
Yes, yes, yes. I'll conclude.
Can I say something?
Yes, madam, please.
Yes, madam. Madam Parvati, madam, please.
The new generation caregivers often show videos when they feed the children, babies, infants and small children. That has to be, you have to stop that. You have to tell them, educate them not to do that. And another thing, I often tell the parents to give the Amrutam Podi after 1 year. That is what I practice. Is it good, Elizabeth? You are telling that below 1 year, it's better not to give Amrutam Podi.
No, madam. Amrutam Podi, they give at 6 months. So many items are there. Accustomed to cereals, pulses, roots and
juices. Yes.
Then you can give. So
the sugar content is so high. So better to avoid it below 1 year.
It is very high. But in malnutrition, it may be good.
Malnutrition is it you can give, but otherwise, ordinary people.
Elizabeth, molasses, is it better than sugar?
It is more acceptable. Raw form, no. Little more raw form may be advisable.
Better.
More refined, it is not good. That is it.
Let me propose.
Congratulations to the whole team. Okay.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, madam.
First of all, let me thank Ketan Bharadwaj sir for presiding the inaugural function of the working group of IYCF, our IYCF chapter. I thank Elizabeth Madam for her motivation, her guidance and support in forming the group and introducing the theme. Let me thank the President-elect Ramesh sir for addressing the audience on this Sunday evening and releasing the video by Anandapuri Hospitals. Let me thank the state office bearers, Jairam sir and Dr. Joni Sebastian in his absence for their constant support. I thank Santosh sir, President IIP Trivandrum for his welcome speech. I thank the dignitaries, Kamat sir, Satish Tiwari sir, Narayanan sir, Dr. Riyas for their felicitations. I thank all the panelists, Dr. Sri Prasad, Dr. Somashekhar, Ajit Krishnan sir and Ashok sir for giving us an academic feast. And Indumati madam was not only the moderator for the panel discussion, she worked behind the curtains alone, that is it, to make this program a grand success. And her passion towards breastfeeding and childhood nutrition is really commendable. Thank you very much, madam. I thank the Anandapuri Hospital team, Gopika, who did the beautiful video for our new chapter. It will be shown shortly. I thank Dr. Meera for her very melodious theme song. I thank Dr. Anju Deepak for helping me with the comparing and Dr. Amit for hosting the Zoom in a perfect manner. And I should thank Lalita Madam, Parvati Madam, and all those seniors who gave their valuable comments here today.
I thank Dr. Praveen, Secretary, and Dr. Sibi, Trisha, for being with us always. And I thank all the delegates and the members for attending this new venture of ours. Thank you.
Thank you, Priya. That was wonderful. Can we play the video if you'd like to see?
Amit, video demo.
Hi everyone. It is very interesting to note that from this year onwards, that is 2021 onwards, the sixth day of sixth month, that is June 6th, is going to be celebrated as the complementary feeding day. As you all know, this complementary feeding is the weakest link in infant nutrition because of the lack of awareness what to give, how to give at 6 months of age. Even though we did not celebrate this so far, it is deep rooted in our culture, that is the Annaprashna or rice giving ceremony at 6 months. Let us capitalize on this and let us start complementary feeding for every baby starting at 6 months of age. And this video from the family of Ananthapuri Hospital is an incredible effort on how to give and what to give at 6 months of age.
I'm Jazia, Senior Dietitian in Ananthapuri Hospital. As you all know, complementary feeding is projected as the bridge between breastfeeding and family port feeding. Since this is the period of rapid growth and development of the baby, complementary foods should be made energy dense by adding jaggery, ghee, butter, oil, etc. Foods can be enriched with micronutrients by fermenting, germinating, and toasting. But most important is that we should be able to offer a dietary diversity without compromising on the energy and protein content of the food. For this, we have to make healthy choices from different food groups like grains, fruits, vegetables, proteins, and dairy products. This variety will prevent the food aversion. Keeping this in mind, we have come forward with a few healthy recipes with easily available raw materials.
I am Dr. Shilpa Abhishekhar. Today we are preparing rice apple blend.
I'm going to prepare healthy mix.
am going to prepare vision soup.
Jazia, going to show the preparation of fruit nut mix. We'll be right back.
Hope you have all enjoyed seeing the preparation of these nutritious and delicious recipes. Now a few tips on how to give these complimentary feeds. First and foremost, practice responsive feeding. That is, you should feed the baby slowly, patiently, looking into his eyes, talking to him and interacting with him. Never force feed him. Then start complimentary feeds at 6 months of age itself and slowly increase the consistency, quantity and variety of foods. In the first 2 months of complimentary feeding, you can give the baby 2 to 3 main meals per day, and thereafter till 2 years it can be 3 to 4 meals, if needed 1 or 2 snacks also. And to start with, the quantity can be 1/4 of a cup measuring 250 ml, but always remember it should be your baby's choice. Some foods he may like more and some less. And never forget to practice hand hygiene as well as food hygiene. By following these few little points, you can develop healthy eating habits in your baby and also make them enjoy their meal times. Thank you.
Okay, that was wonderful video. Ananthapuri group, huh? Very nice.
Very nice postgraduate.
Very nicely done. Very
to do
done.
This demonstrations.
And then, anyway, everything went on well. I think there are some people who are not behind only. You wanted that song, eh? Where is
Ondangudi, Amit.
Amit, thanks for
Amit.
So patient. കുമ്പാളി മാമുണ്ട് ചാഞ്ചാടു പച്ചക്കറിക്കായത്തട്ട് ഒരു മുത്തശ്ശി പൊട്ടറ്റു ചൊല്ലി കുഞ്ഞോളി കുമ്പാളി മാമുണ്ട് ചാഞ്ചാടു മില്ലരി പിഞ്ചുപോലും ചുമ്മാ കള്ള കണ്ണീരൊഴുക്കി തക്കാളി പപ്പാളി അച്ചിങ്ങ മുച്ചിങ്ങ പിച്ചിങ്ങയോടൊപ്പം പിച്ച് നടന്ന് ചൊല്ലി കുഞ്ഞോളി കുമ്പാളി മാമുണ്ട് ചാഞ്ചാട് കുഞ്ഞോളി കുമ്പാളി മാമുണ്ട് ചാഞ്ചാട് കുഞ്ഞോളി കുമ്പാളി മാമുണ്ട് ചാഞ്ചാട്
താങ്ക്സ് അമിത് അമിത് എവിടെ അമിത് ഐ ലൈക്ക് ടു സീ യു യു ഹിയർ Okay, thank you so much. I want to take a photograph of all of us. Yeah, screenshot. Thanks a lot, Amit. I think you have really done it. Really helpful. Priya, thank you so much. A lot of time is when I think we leave. Right?
Thank you, madam.
Anju, thank you. Thank you so much. Enjoyed.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye.
Well organized.
Okay. At least something we wanted to do. And I'm going to another way.
That was very
God's
good.
Grace. That's all I would say. Okay.
Last year, Kamala, hi. Oh, no, Kamala.
ഫാസ്റ്റ് ആയിട്ട്
ബൈ ഗുഡ് നൈറ്റ്
ബൈ